Thank you very much, Rajat, for giving me this opportunity to be a part of this forum. So we have today spoken a lot about the tractor as well as the implements industry. Great to hear a lot of commentaries from people who have spent time in the industry. The only most important thing which now needs to be spoken about is what is happening to farmers and how is the health of the farmers. Finally, it is a consumption product for the farmer, and whatever sales that you see in the sector depends upon what is finally the health of the farmer, either in terms of cash, you know, his ability to borrow from the market and then make these purchases. So apart from awareness, apart from the right products being there in the market, government policies, farmer health is going to be an important monitorable for the sector. CRISIL exactly does that. We have offerings where we track farm profitability on a regular basis. It is a combination of desk research as well as on the ground interactions which helps us to come up with these outputs. And I'll be sharing a few conclusions with you which may be of help for further discussions. Given that the evening has a lot more agenda items, I'll not take a lot of time. 15 minutes is what I promise, I'll wind up. So let's go on to the first slide where I'm just summing up what's happening in the Indian economy. Numbers are not important. What is important are the color shades. So if you look at from the left to the right, over the last 7 to 8 years, you are seeing the reds going down and the oranges and the greens actually increasing. And that is what is going to be most important for the Indian economy. We are talking about a good growth rate. We are talking about revival in growth rate on a sustained basis. And that is going to be positive. Positive from the point of view of how government would take initiatives therefore to help the farmers. If you move on to the next slide. However, everything doesn't seem to be very good on the agri side of it. So what I have plotted on this graph is agri GDP in real terms and the share of agri in the overall GDP. So while we are recovering in the overall GDP point of view, agri share in the overall GDP has been going down and that remains an area of concern. Therefore, if we want to ensure that farm mechanization levels should improve, tractor penetration or power per farm should go up, it is important that there's something done about this. Now, if you look at India, despite of everything that's spoken about irrigation or about micro-irrigation, one of the most important thing is if I track agri GDP in real terms, with rainfall deviation, it tells me a story. The story is that even today, we are totally dependent on what are going to be the scenario for southwest monsoons. And if the monsoons are good, you are going to see a good GDP growth rate on the agri side. And that is a worrying thing. Unless and until you do not see micro-irrigation adoption as well as this chart showing a positive deviation, irrespective of what happens to rains, my agri GDP will continue to show an improving or a stable growth rate. That is what is going to make a difference to adoption of newer production techniques. So this continues to remain a monitorable for the Indian economy and for Indian agriculture. Moving on, I think it's very important to develop ecosystems, and that's what also was being spoken about in the previous session. I have plotted over here something that CRISIL tracks, which is mandi prices across 2000 mandis, and we track it with on a weighted average basis looking at what are the arrivals in the mandi, and it tells you a story. The story is that you are seeing volatility in mandi prices. If you look at 10 quarters, you will see that there is hardly any growth in the mandi prices that is evident. And there has been ups and downs. So you look at what are the factors that are contributing to this, and the bottom chart, it is pulses, which showed a sharp drop, almost a 70% drop on an aggregated basis across pulse prices. And that is what you result in, no improvement in mandi prices over 3 years. Now that is a concerning factor and it is a part of the ecosystem. So pulses went through a transition where over the last 4 to 5 years you have seen a continuous improvement in production. There were people who were talking about yields, and on one side while we are talking about yields, on the other side the question is that do we have the capacity to absorb the higher production that is going to happen in the market. And if we are not going to have a capacity, then this is what you will see, where drop in mandi prices is going to hamper farmers and their consumption capability significantly. So the next question for all of us to answer is, how do we develop the market ecosystem such that exports becomes a foreseeable opportunity? Just allowing exports in the pulses space or in any agri commodity space is not going to help. You need to have silos, you need to have warehouses, infrastructure at ports that is going to enable this to grow on a more sustained basis. So that remains a monitorable. Any significantly higher production gets detrimental to farm profits. Now, given that we have looked at what's happening to real GDP, which is nothing else but a proxy for production, we have looked at what's happening to prices, let's look at what is the final impact on farmers. So if we move on, what we have done over here is the top 14-15 commodities that account for almost 70% of the sown area and a large proportion of farmer profits, we track in terms of tracking what is happening to farm profitability. These crops clearly show you that there are outliers. You have crops like sugarcane, paddy, wheat, where there is enough government support, there is enough procurement that's happening, almost one third being procured by the government for wheat and paddy, and you see sustained good profits. These profits that I have plotted are at C2 level. So they may not necessarily be exact cash profits. If I convert this into cash profits, you will still not see cash profits going significantly more than 80-90,000 rupees per hectare. Now, with this scenario where your cash profits are skewed towards a few crops, you are going to face a situation which is not going to be sustainable again. Either farmers structurally would want to shift to newer crops, but because of weather conditions or farm conditions, they may not be able to, or they may keep reducing the acreage of that particular crop. I think that is the trend we are seeing in cotton. The cotton seeds is a segment which has seen a lot of issues over the last 3 years. BT variety of cotton seeds have seen capping of pricing by the government. Therefore, leading international players who had the cotton seeds BT variety have decided to go off new introduction of BT varieties. And with efficacy levels of the existing BT variety going down, we are seeing increasing instances of pink bollworm attacks on cotton crops and reducing profitability, which is again evident in the chart which I showed you before. Now, if I move on to what does that mean? That means that states where procurements are pretty good, like Punjab, where wheat procurements is pretty good by the government, consistently show higher profits, are also large contributors of the total profits which I'm showing to you on the right. Whereas there are other states which are not able to match up. Also, there's a lot of volatility in your profits. So look at the fourth state from top, Madhya Pradesh. You see profits coming down significantly to 10,000 levels and then moving up to 15,000 levels. Something that happened in line with pulses profitability. If you look at states like Kolkata, West Bengal, you will see that the yields of the rice crop, which is prevalent in Kolkata, is extremely low, which results into consistently low profits for Kolkata farmers. I think this also marries pretty well with what somebody said, that penetration levels of farm equipment is much higher in states like Punjab and Haryana. A, they have larger farms. B, they have the money to spend on those farms. So tracking this at a state level is a prerequisite for anybody who is planning a vast expansion strategy in India. Let's move on to the end result of it. So I think we track all input segments, and clearly there is a benefit that tractors and farm equipments have in terms of the returns that they earn. So my vertical axis is the industry revenue growth rate that you have seen over the last 3 years. So it's average, and therefore you will see muted or lower numbers. Both tractors, farm equipments all fall into the 10 to 15% band. Whereas if you look at average ROCEs, tractors win with significantly high ROCEs given a consolidated industry and very high utilization levels. Farm equipments, because of the number of equipments which are present and its extremely fragmented and regional market, sees a little lower returns, but again higher than the other input segments. The deal over here is that the potential to earn profits which are substantially higher than other segments is much higher in the tractor and the farm equipment segment as compared to the other input segments in India. How we have this sustained over a longer period of time is the question that is going to be dependent upon the health of the farmers. If I have to move on, and somebody spoke about policy, so what we did is, this has been an election year and there have been enough and more freebies which have been announced by either state government or the central government. So I just quickly put on to the map of India what are the announcements which are being done by various state governments. And you will be shocked to know that you have almost 2.1 lakh crore, which is almost rupees 2 trillion, which are being spent by various state and central governments for giving just freebies to farmers. They are either in the form of loan waivers or they are in the form of compensating for difference between mandi prices and the MSP prices. With all this, we believe two things are set to happen. Wherever disbursements would take place, cash in the hands of farmers can go up to as high as 7,000 to 10,000 rupees in specific states. Despite of these disbursements happening, bankers and all the financiers will get extremely cautious about the market, because loan waivers mean that even good farmers say that they will not pay, and that's not going to be very good for the industry. So why?
I have a question. This is guaranteed by the state government that if the bank doesn't get it, the state government pays the bank.
Yeah, but for example, if you look at states like Uttar Pradesh, so the last loan waiver that when they did, they said that they would issue bonds to make payments to the bankers. And they phased off that over a 3-year period, which only means that the provisioning which needs to be done by the bankers would increase. So there's a staggered payment, plus the farmer who was good yesterday turns bad today. And the amount that becomes due becomes significantly huge. So that is what then becomes a concern for financiers, for sure. So with this, what we believe is that the tractor industry that had been doing pretty well, with almost a 20% growth rate that they saw in FY18, a little moderation in volumes in FY19 is expected to grow at around 3 to 5%. Two reasons. A, dispersion of rains is not expected to be very good. This has also been the case over the last 2 years, where southern states have not received proportionate rainfall as compared to the northern states. So that remains a worry. Reservoir levels in many of the southern states are falling much lower than the normal levels. That was also the concern during the Rabi season. So we are cautious on the dispersion of rains. Second, inventory levels at the retail side continue to remain a little high. We have already seen rounds of correction in March and April in the volume numbers for wholesale, at wholesale level, and we believe that trend can continue for the next 2 months. So with that, let me move on to the last slide, where I'm summing it up all. Monsoons remain critical for the Indian farm industry and the overall input segment. And that is not a very positive thing for the sector for long-term sustenance. We believe segments like tractors and farm equipments have very high potential in India, and potential both in terms of growth as well as in terms of good profitability. The only thing that is needed is sustained farm incomes. The spread of the farm incomes need to move from the top two states, which is Punjab and Haryana, to the rest of the country as well. And C, cropping patterns may undergo transitions, which may make it a little difficult in terms of product planning because of the kind of profit levels that you are seeing in specific crops as compared to the others. So thank you for that. I finished bang on in 15 minutes.